Namaste, dear students. We are aware of the terms like current, ampere, ammeter, potential difference, volt, voltmeter, electrical symbols, etc. At the end of today's session, we'll be able to plan and conduct investigations and experiments based on Ohm's law, draw simple circuit diagrams, analyze and interpret data and graphs, handle tools and laboratory apparatus properly. In the last session, we discovered that a cell or a battery provides a potential difference which results in the flow of electric current. This means that there is a relation between potential difference and current. Let's explore this relationship by doing a simple experiment. You can see this wire. I have taken this wire of a standard resistance. You can also observe that there is an ammeter, a voltmeter, these connecting wires, a key, a rheostat, and cells. We have connected the circuit according to the standard circuit diagram, which you can see on your screen. You have to notice that the voltmeter is connected in parallel with the resistance wire, but the ammeter is connected end to end, which means it is in series with the resistance wire. As soon as I plug the key, we can note that the readings in the ammeter and the voltmeter have started showing. I can use two batteries or three batteries or even increase the voltage to another level to see the increase in current. There are many ways to realize this experiment. As I just said, that I can increase the number of cells up to a certain limit, or change the value of potential difference by using a device called a battery eliminator. And the third way is to use the rheostat, which I have already connected in the circuit. I'm sure you're excited to know that what is this device which is called the rheostat. You will understand the principle behind working of the rheostat once you understand Ohm's law. For the time being, just remember that by changing the position of the rider on the rheostat, I can change the potential difference in the circuit. And just in case if you're wondering what is the rider, this is the rider of the rheostat. It has three connections, 1, 2, and 3. I have used 2, this being the rider. Once I change the position of the rider, the value of potential difference and hence the current changes, which can be noticed in both the devices, the voltmeter and the ammeter. Now you have to tabulate your findings. For a particular value of voltage, what is the value of current? What happens to the value of current if the voltage increases or decreases? After we tabulate, let us plot a graph between voltage and current. You will observe that the VI graph is a straight line that passes through the origin of the graph. Remember, V by I is a constant ratio. In 1827, a German physicist, George Simon Ohm, found out the relationship between current flowing in the metallic wire and the potential difference across its terminals. The potential difference V across the ends of a given metallic wire in an electric circuit is directly proportional to the current flowing through it, provided its temperature remains the same. And children, remember, this is called the Ohm's law. So V is proportional to I. We have to remove the proportionality sign and add a constant. And the constant in this case is capital R. R means resistance of the wire. And hence we have the Ohm's law in mathematical form, which is V equal to I R. R, which is resistance, is a constant for a given metallic wire and at a given temperature, and of course is called resistance, I just told you. It is the property of the conductor to resist or to oppose the flow of current through it. The SI unit is ohm, which is represented by the Greek letter omega. According to Ohm's law, R equals V upon I. The current through the resistor is inversely proportional to its resistance. So if the resistance is doubled, I am sure you have guessed, the current gets halved. In many practical cases, it is necessary to increase or decrease the current in an electrical circuit. A component used to regulate current without changing the voltage source is called variable resistance, and in an electric circuit, this device is called rheostat, which you just saw in the experiment we did. It is often used to change the resistance in the circuit. We will now study about electrical resistance of a conductor with the help of the following activity. You can now connect the circuit using two cells, a nichrome wire, a key, and an ammeter. We have placed this resistance wire between the ammeter and the key and have connected it to the cells. Once I plug in the key, I can note the reading on the ammeter. I can actually replace this wire with different components like a bulb, a wooden spoon, some rubber bands, or any other material. You will notice that certain components offer an easy path for the flow of electric current, while the others resist the flow. Motion of electrons in an electric circuit constitutes an electric current. The electrons, however, are not completely free to move within a conductor. They are restrained by the attraction of the atoms among which they move. Thus, motion of electrons through a conductor is retarded by its resistance. A component of a given size that offers low resistance is a good conductor. A conductor having some appreciable resistance is called a resistor. A component of identical size that offers a higher resistance is a poor conductor, and an insulator of the same size offers even higher resistance. Why don't you design a circuit and perform simple experiment? Classify materials around you as conductors, insulators, and resistors. Once again, you can connect a circuit with a battery, key, and an ammeter. Take the resistance wire of length, let us say 5 centimeters, and check the reading of the ammeter. Double the length of the wire and check the reading again. Once again, keep the length of the wire same, but take a thicker wire and now check the reading of the ammeter. You will observe the ammeter reading decreases to 1/2 when the length of the wire is doubled. The ammeter reading is increased when a thicker wire of the same material and of the same length is used in the wire. A change in ammeter reading is observed when a wire of different material of same length and same area of cross section is used. So, we conclude the resistance of the conductor depends on its length, on its area of cross section, and on the nature of its material. Precise measurements have shown that resistance of a uniform metallic conductor is directly proportional to its length, inversely proportional to the area of cross section. I want to give you a simple analogy. Just think that you have to travel by road from Delhi to Meerut and by road from Delhi to Mumbai, assuming that both the roads are equally crowded. Only difference is the length of the road. In which case will you encounter more traffic signals? When the route is shorter and the conditions are the same, our common sense tells us that shorter is the route, less are the traffic signals. So more is the length of the wire, more are the chances of collisions or obstructions, or we can say the resistance of the wire. So remember that resistance is directly proportional to the length, which means more is the length, more is the resistance. By the way, length of the conductor. Now let's assume you are walking on a wide road and then you are walking on a narrow road. The probability of a traffic jam on a narrow road is more, obviously. So less area means more traffic jams. In other words, more resistance in case of a thin wire. So what do you understand from this analogy? That resistance is inversely proportional to the area of cross section of the wire, which means thicker is the wire, lesser is the resistance. So combining both the equations, I get R is proportional to L upon A, direct proportionality to length and inverse proportionality to area of cross section. I have to remove the proportionality sign and add a constant. So in this case, I introduce you to a new constant called rho. It is a constant of proportionality and is called electrical resistivity of the material of the conductor. The SI unit of resistivity is ohm meter. It is the characteristic property of the material. The metals and alloys have very low resistivity in the range of 10 raised to power minus 8 ohm meter to 10 raised to power minus 6 ohm meters. They are good conductors of electricity. Insulators like rubber, glass have resistivity of the order of 10 raised to power 12 to 10 raised to power 17 ohm meter. Both the resistance and resistivity of a material may vary with temperature. Have you ever wondered why tungsten is used as a filament of a bulb? Why are copper wires used as connecting wires? Try to find out the answers. Also remember, alloys do not oxidize or burn readily at high temperatures. For this reason, they are commonly used in electrical heating devices like electric iron, toasters, etc. It is now the time for you all to wear your thinking caps and to do some numericals similar to what you can see on your screen. So, children, at the end of this session, we have understood the relationship between voltage, current, and resistance. The difference between resistance and resistivity. Factors on which these two depend. Applications of these in daily life, like connecting wires, electrical appliances, bulbs, etc. So, till we meet next time, keep practicing, keep observing, and keep questioning. Namaste.